Hi, this is Andy from Highway and Heavy Parts, and I want to talk to you about our most frequently asked question, engine break-in, and how to break an engine in. One of my biggest concerns for customers is after engine overhaul or repair is the break-in procedure. Unfortunately, we hear of customers that are so conscientious that they let their truck sit and idle for a couple hours, or they put it at high idle after it's overhauled because they don't want to give it back to the customer, or they don't want to take it on the road and then find they have a leak or a problem, so they let it idle. Absolutely a no-no. You cannot let the engine idle. It has to be within the first 10 minutes of operation, 3/4 of an engine load on it for 3 to 4 hours operation. If you let it idle, you really run the risk of having oil consumption, low power, high fuel consumption. And that's not a product problem, that's a workmanship problem. So our goal is to make sure that when you overhaul the engine, you do all the work the right way, but the last and most important step, the break-in procedure, is done as well. That's what a lot of people are not familiar with. Why do you break in a diesel engine? It is important to break in a diesel engine because it controls your oil consumption, it controls your fuel economy, and it affects your power. These three items are some of the things that customers expect when they overhaul an engine or repair an engine, that they are improved. If you don't break the engine in properly, all three of these things can be worse than when the engine came into your shop. So how do you break in an engine? Obviously, we always want you to refer back to the manufacturer's service manual. They all have their procedures. I'm going to summarize those procedures for you, and there's basically two different ways that you can accomplish that. The break-in procedure means put the load on the engine. So we can back it on the dyno, we can load the engine. Nice and easy. Unfortunately, most of us don't have dynos to break in engines, so we're forced to load the engine a different way. You can take it to the hills, and you can run in the hills, and you can load the engine that way. A lot of places don't have hills to load the engine, so then how do you do it? Do you put a loaded trailer behind it? Do you lug the engine and get the boost pressure up? However you accomplish the load, you can verify that you're loading the engine by your boost pressure gauge. Engine break-in, whose responsibility is it? I believe it's both customer and repair shop. The reason I say that is it is very hard to break in an engine at a repair shop, as well as it's in the customer's best interest to have the engine broken in properly. So there's a couple of ways working together that you can break an engine in better than even having a dyno. A lot of our customers will bring a loaded trailer to the repair shop and have it ready for pickup as soon as the engine's done. Many of our customers communicate with the repair shop and ask to be there when the engine is started. That way the customer is actually able to go out and drive his engine and put the 3 to 4 hours of road time on that engine with a loaded trailer, not raising the shop rate, not having to bill more hours, and the shop and the customer are working together with great communication. Sometimes shops don't like to have the customer there on the first startup in case things don't go perfect. Totally understandable. Start that engine, let it run, check your fluids, get a hold of the customer, let him come in and drive it. Or make sure that when the customer does leave, he's going to break that engine in. But it's both parties' responsibility, customer and repair shop, to make sure the break-in procedure happens. Thank you for watching this video today. We talked about how to break an engine in, why to break an engine in, and who's responsible for it. We have a blog that covers all of the topics, and you're more than welcome to call us anytime.